They can allow us to ask the right questions.
Exactly. Yeah. It's exactly what they
because
do.
Isn't it that often today, look at, for example, ecology, look at racism, tolerance. We know we have a serious problem, but the very way we formulate the problem, it's part of the problem. For example, tolerance.
You're singing my song.
Yeah, but you see, and here...
How you ask the question determines the answer.
Yeah, and this, I think, is our task. Right. So when French, who even laugh at me as a philosopher, nonetheless, with some kind of a superstitious respect, somebody asks me, but tell us, or at Wall Street they ask me, but tell us what to do, what... No, I don't know what to do. I don't have a ready-made
answer. You're talking about the fact you went down to speak to the people at Occupy Wall Street.
Yeah.
And they all want to know, tell us, you know... Help us understand what to do.
Yeah, no.
And you said no.
No.
What did you tell them, though?
What was your
message to those people that are down
that
there?
It's time to think. That they my basic message was, and I think it was totally correct, that they shouldn't fall in love with themselves. By this I mean, what nice time we have here, this immediate freedom, ecstatic, back to old hippie days.
Yes.
No, the true problem is the day after. What of this will be translated into our daily lives, really made some changes and so on. And for this, there are no fast answers, which is why, on the other hand, I also don't totally agree, although it was probably well meant, with what President Bill Clinton said. These protests are okay, but they should translate into concrete demands what they want. No, it's a little bit deeper. We all know that our societies are approaching some deeper deadlocks, dilemmas, from ecology to, status of capitalism, intellectual property, biogenetics. These are deep problems. And I want to make this very clear so that I will not be perceived as a kind of a nostalgic idiot. I'm only a communist in the sense that communism is for me the name of these problems, which are problems of the commons. Like, nature out there is our common ground.
Right.
And so on.
I got you.
I'm not communist at the level of answers. I'm the first to admit 20th
you're not
century
communist in the area of Marxism-Leninism.
We can learn something of Marx, but not in the sense of easy solutions. Like, the Leninist Party is certainly not the answer. The 20th century communism was... It did some good things here and there, universal education, blah, blah. But basically, let's face it, it was a fiasco. And we have
Why was it a fiasco in your judgment?
I don't have a clear theory, and this is why I'm so obsessed with the Stalinist phenomenon. Because I think... it's really mysterious how something which here I disagree with right-wing or liberal critics.
Right.
Look, at the beginning, October Revolution did have a tremendous emancipatory potential. It did have. It liberated women, society exploded, and then we know into what it turned. It was something much more terrifying than fascism. Let me simplify it. Fascists were bad guys who said they planned to do bad things and then did. What a surprise, they did it, yes.
Right.
So, this is why in fascism, or especially Nazism, you don't have the figure of Nazi dissidents. While Stalinist communism even all the time had to fight with disappointed communists who. At the same time, let me be clear.
The gulag started early.
Yeah, but at the same time, I'm not saying, at the beginning everything was okay and so on. You know, this Trotskyite story.
Right.
If only Lenin were to survive 2 years more, made a pact with Trotsky against Lenin.
Yeah.
No. There was a kind of at least general tendency that Leninism had to become Stalinism. I have no illusions there, but that's what makes it truly
tragic.
There were
no illusions that Leninism had to become Stalinism.
No, yeah, it had to, in a way. I don't think there was a real alternative in the sense of, if only...
But Gorbachev thought he could reform communism. That was his own motivation. And then Yeltsin comes along and says, no, you can't reform it, you have to,
Yeah, but the problem with Yeltsin, I think...
What was the problem with Gorbachev, though? Was it reformable, in your judgment?
That communism, no, absolutely not.
Absolutely.
Absolutely. On the other hand, the problem with Yeltsin was that he did it in a very chaotic way. Right. Like, if you look at how the Chinese did it, they started privatization, capitalism, in a very intelligent way. They started with small consumerist industry, right. tested it there, then right. slowly expanded it.
Right.
The Russians did it exactly the opposite. They started it with banks and natural resources, so they got the most non-productive capitalism which you can imagine. New rich guys, tycoons, whose capitalism was not productive. They just were selling their natural resources and so on.
The oligarchs.
The oligarchs,
exactly.
Yeah.
Now, here's an idea that you have propounded, which is the notion that while often capitalism and democracy have gone hand in hand, you're suggesting that with the rise of China, with a kind of state capitalism, you may very well not see, for the first time in history, democracy follow. And that may be a threat to the order in itself.
Yeah, no, what I'm saying is that, again, I'm not just blindly anti-capitalist. Let's be serious. Capitalism is the most productive social order in the history of humanity. And let me be very clear. Now, some radical leftist will lynch me for saying this, but
yes,
can you imagine in the entire history of humanity, an era in which so many people lived such relatively free lives and safe lives in relative welfare as, let's say, in Western Europe in the last 50, 60 years. Mm. So let's, as they put it in the church, let's recognize to the devil what belongs to the devil. What I'm saying is that these times are passing. And
what times are passing?
This times of democracy being, capitalism able to claim that it...
It's a forerunner to a democracy.
Yeah. That what happens for me in China is that we have, let's be clear, we have a capitalism which is more dynamic, productive, at least it looks now, than Western capitalism. And don't put it
And democracy in the United States is in a sense of paralysis.
Yeah.
Over making decisions that are in the interest.
Yeah. And again, I don't believe those who said, China were to have democracy, it would have been even better. Unfortunately, it wouldn't. Because it's not just China. Look at Singapore is the key, I think. Do you know that when Deng Xiaoping started his reforms, he visited Singapore?
Lee Kuan Yew.
Ah, here you are touching a key point. My German friend, Peter Sloterdijk, a philosopher, when he asked himself a beautiful question. Can we imagine to which person from our time they will be building monuments 100 years from now in the future? He said Lee Kuan Yew. Because he invented so-called capitalism with Asian values, which means, to cut things short, authoritarian capitalism.
He invented the formula.
Even Deng Xiaoping said this is a model for all China.
That's exactly
and this is what
right.
I would worry about.
More than that, he sent lots of Chinese to Singapore to study what they had done in order to bring it back.
Yeah. So again, I'm not saying you liberals are traitors. I'm saying if you are a sincere liberal, start thinking about this. How really to save the freedoms that we enjoy.
Let me move you to the Arab Spring and how what your observations are about what's happened. From Tunisia to Libya.
Basically, I think it's an extremely positive thing. Because, you know, we in Western Europe, at least, and here, all the time we dismiss Arabs are those guys, you can mobilize them en masse only on anti-Semitism, religious fundamentalism, nationalism. No, here we got what we wanted. A secular revolt for freedom, democracy, and so on. Of course, this brings...
Not about ideology at all.
Okay, here maybe I disagree because what do you mean by ideology?
Well, I don't know. You tell me. But it was about dignity. It was about dignity. It was about responsibility. It was about
freedom. Solidarity, all those things.
Yeah, that
it was
well
a wonderful
ideology,
event.
But it wasn't religious based. It wasn't.
No. It clearly wasn't.
There was no ism behind it. Or not?
Yeah. What do you mean by ism?
Well, I don't.
Because you know,
communism, fascism. Some other kind of ism.
You know what's my problem? That I don't believe in this. Like, for me, ideology often, like, I don't think there is some kind of innocent out of all ideologies consciousness or whatever. Right. Aren't we all the time in ideologies?
Yes,
in the sense of, of course you can say no ism, but if you look closely at what people were demanding them, you can clearly see what they took from the Arab tradition, from the Western tradition. I don't believe
You think they're defining some new...
Potentially. Potentially.